In this abstract presentation, I will give you an introduction to our last year's MIKAI paper on self-supervised context feature learning, a work co-authored by Hannes Nickisch from Philips and by Matthias Heinrich. So let's start with the problem that made us think about self-supervised learning in the context of medical imaging in the first place. I'm sure that most of you are familiar with CNNs. A major driving force for their popularity is undoubtedly due to the so-called transfer learning. In short, a huge variety of tasks on your own small datasets benefits from larger pre-trained models by only performing minor changes to the networks, for example, adapting the last layer's weights. However, while there are these powerful feature extractors available for 2D data, because they could be pre-trained on a huge number of labeled images, think about the ImageNet challenge, so far we have no pre-trained models in medical imaging. While one prerequisite for the success of CNNs in the computer vision community is also fulfilled in the medical domain, we have a huge amount of image data available, and radiologists would be more than glad if we could assist them with automated solutions. The second part poses the main limitation. There is a lack of voxel-wise labeled images to provide the ground truth that is necessary to learn, for example, organ detection tasks. Nevertheless, with the image data being available, although without labels, we can still ask ourselves, is there a way to pre-train 3D CNNs in medical imaging that can be fine-tuned to subsequent different tasks? Obviously, we are not the first people that encountered this problem, and Karl Dorsch et al. Came up with the idea of context prediction in their ICCV 2015 work. As you can see from the image of a cat here, the training labels are generated automatically just by the spatial relation of two image patches. In this case, a classification network would have to learn that the right ear of a cat is usually somewhere on the upper right side of the nose. Dorsch et al. Could demonstrate that this auxiliary task forced the networks to learn expressive feature extraction layers and could be employed for other tasks. But now, when it comes to the medical domain, we have to deal with 3D data of volumes of CT or MRI scanners. As you expect, the memory demand often is a problem when processing these images. But in comparison to the 2D image data, the lower resolution also poses problems when you naively extend the Dorsch approach to 3D data. When you think of the degree of details in the cat image, you realize that it is much harder to learn expressive image filters on this abdominal scan, for example. Since overlapping image patches would simplify the task too much, you now have to balance a trade-off. If your receptive field is too small, you wouldn't capture enough context in homogeneous areas to learn the spatial relations of different tissue types. Inside the liver, the relation is hard to predict. Again, when your receptive field becomes too large, the task becomes too easy, because the network can see the surrounding of the patient. We want to get rid of this trade-off problem, where you need to balance your box size. Furthermore, so far this problem was formulated as a classification task with only 6 possible outcomes, like left-right, front, behind, and up and down. In order to formulate an auxiliary task in terms of a regression problem, we switched the descriptor design with respect to its receptive field, as shown above, from 3D to 2.5D. So what have we done to develop a pre-training scheme for 3D medical data? This slide gives an overview of the complete pipeline, which I will present to you in more detail now. The first thing that you have to realize and keep in mind is that we train in total 3 CNNs that deal with 2D data, one per image axis. In the end, per voxel, we concatenate all descriptor vectors per dimension. Let's go into details on how the training per image axis works. Consider this image volume. To generate training pairs, at first, we draw a random slice along the current axis. And now again, we randomly draw a second slice from the volume. Note that we make sure that there is a sufficient distance in between to prevent the network from seeing too similar content in both layers. Now we extract a patch from the first slice that is centered around some position XY. This position is marked by the orange dot in both planes. Since we secured to have a sufficiently different image content in the second slice, we are no longer forced to place the patch completely outside the region of the first patch. In fact, we can now move freely along the plane and formulate our auxiliary task as a regression problem. We randomly sampled two offset values, delta 1 and delta 2, to alter the patch center, and it is these values that our network now has to predict. In doing so, our intuition is that the network has to encode the anatomical knowledge of the patients intrinsically. In total, we use two different formulations of the same problem setting. The first approach uses a CNN that directly regresses the delta values as two-dimensional output. The second approach encoded the same offset information as heat map to serve as ground truth during training. And finally, when we have trained one network per axis, we can encode each voxel by the concatenation of three two-dimensional CNNs. Now we have to evaluate the expressiveness of our learned descriptors. To this end, we train our CNNs on the contrast-enhanced visceral CT silver corpus data. We evaluate it on the gold corpus data with its ground truth annotations provided by medical experts. Because we don't want to obscure our findings by fine-tuning to other tasks, where you would afterwards not be able to separate the contributions of the pre-training from the fine-tuning, we fixed our pre-trained CNNs and held its weight static. The only assumption is that after training, we now have access to labeled image data. This allows us to extract descriptors from unseen test images. We also extract the descriptors from the atlas images and are therefore able to perform an approximate k-nearest neighbor search using our vantage point forest approach. Having found the closest descriptor matches, we advise the label from the atlas image at this position to the unseen test image. Fortunately, both of our proposed methods perform best for an organ label transfer task and achieve dye scores of over 60% accuracy without any fine-tuning to this task. Compared to the 6-class classification implementation by the naive extension of the Dorsch method, our heat map implementation could gain nearly 10% increase in terms of dye scores. And it is also interesting to mention that we outperformed a sophisticated one-shot segmentation approach by Roy et al. That had access to labeled images during training. To provide you with some visual results, you can see that, again, I have to stress it, without any fine-tuning, our heatmap approach produces reasonable organ labelings. To give you more quantitative results, you can see how the accuracy of the different examined methods depends on the atlas dataset size. On the right-hand side, we use a TSNE plot to visualize the high-dimensional descriptor clusters of our naive Dorsch extension and the best-performing heatmap solution. As you can see, our approach also separated the liver and the spleen cluster here in blue and orange better than the original Dorsch approach, so that we also visually encounter less errors between liver and spleen here for this example patient. To summarize our approach in a short take-home message, we developed a solution to pre-train networks on 3D medical image data without the need for ground truth labels. For more details, see our paper that you will find also alongside Jupyter notebooks containing the training routine in our GitHub repository at the link above. Thank you.